Good morning. Thank you for joining us with Unity of Chattanooga. I'm Keith Noyes, a longtime member of Unity, and we welcome you to our online services this day. Behind me is our website information. If there's any questions or needs you have, please feel free to explore that after the service. Follow us on Facebook and make comments with emojis if you'd like during the service. And if there's any prayer needs, realize that Silent Unity is available 24/7, 365 for anyone with prayer needs. Their number is 816-969-2000. Again, we thank you for joining us this day. We greet you with open arms and open hearts and welcome you to the service. Here's Rev Jon with Grace Like Rain.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a soul like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I can see so clearly. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains washed away, they're washed away. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears all relieved. Oh yeah. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Oh yeah. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away, they're washed away. Oh yeah, washed away. Hey, ooh. Oh, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shine as that noonday sun, all we've known less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Hallelujah. Down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away, they're washed away. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away. Yeah, they're washed away. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Welcome to Unity of Chattanooga. I'm Reverend Fayann. Thank you, Reverend Jon Scott, for your presence with us today. We appreciate you and glad that you could be with us. We know that you're healing 100%, so thank you for joining us. This is the season of Lent, the beginning of February the 17th. And from the Daily Word, I'd like to read a couple paragraphs. And so it says, I commit to deepening my spiritual understanding and more fully expressing my divinity. I solemnly ask which habits or thought patterns are keeping me from being the person I want to be. I make a sacred commitment to the process of allowing the pure expression of my Christ nature to shine brightly through and as me. Let's join together in prayer. Oh, we give thanks for this time. We give thanks for John's presence with us, that he is whole and healthy, that everyone that has had the COVID-19 virus be whole and healthy. And we bless each on their journey. And during this time of Lent, we reflect upon ourselves and we look at the things that maybe we aren't the most proud of. Maybe we aren't the most pleased with ourselves that we are holding some of these patterns in our lives. You know, we reflect upon this last year and the things that we did and who we are. Is there something that I need to transform? Is there something that I need to release? And as I look at myself honestly and humbly, I know that the grace of God is with me. That there isn't anything that I can't change. I am blessed to look at myself and to know that I have a way to be a better person. And I am grateful. Grateful for this opportunity to be on my journey, to be on my way to being the person that I came here to be. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen. Now, Reverend Jon Scott is going to sing for us, and he's going to give us a talk on love. Isn't it interesting? The last two people that have been our guest speakers have talked on love also. So it's a wonderful topic. And then John's going to do the meditation. So thank you, John, for being with us. Reverend Jon Scott.
Hello, everybody. Good morning to you. I hope you've had a wonderful week. I'm so glad to be able to be with you. We were supposed to be able to, are supposed to be with you already this month, but COVID-19 had another plan and certainly affected everything about what was going on in our life. I'm not going to bore you with all the details on that. I'll just say that I'm more thankful for the breath I breathe today than I was just a couple of weeks ago, and more thankful for life in general than I was. And our heart goes out to all of those who have passed away, and those who have lost loved ones to this terrible virus. We send our thoughts and our prayers out to them. Of course, all of you know we passed a milestone in this country of 500,000 people who have lost their lives to complications with COVID-19 and or the coronavirus itself. So we send our love and our prayers out to everyone who has had to deal with that. I can tell you this, it is it's an interesting struggle. So we send our love. But it's good to be back with you. I'm finally getting my voice back. For a minute I was sounding like the Godfather. I'm making an offer you can't refuse. And so thankful to have my voice just really starting to come back, and just very thankful and honored to be with you. My overarching theme with our community for this year is going beyond the veil. And so each month we're attaching some kind of a theme, a sub-theme to that. And so this month we're looking at loving beyond the veil, choosing to unveil, to truly unveil our love. For first of all, I'll say this, the first portion of this is loving yourself. Because if you don't love yourself, it's impossible to love others. You need to make that deposit within your own soul that gives you the ability to withdraw when others need that love from you. If you can't build yourself up and love yourself, why would you expect anyone else to love you? So many times we beat ourselves up and we're critical of ourselves, and the way we speak to ourselves, our self-talk, is very diminishing and devaluing. And the world needs you to be operating at your fullest potential. The world needs you to be living from the Dharma that you've been called to in this life. And the best way to do that is to activate love toward yourself. Self-actualization, self-realization, self-love instead of self-loathing. What is it that you say about yourself? Do you find yourself actually talking people out of compliments that they give to you? What is it about our society that has a tendency to do that? I've watched so many people do that. Somebody walk up to them and say, "Oh my gosh, your hair just looks so great today." And then they give you 14 reasons why you shouldn't have complimented them to start with. We're so self-critical. Now, why is that? Why is that? We're so ashamed often of our own selves. We're afraid of our own bodies, sometimes afraid of our own shadows. We don't even like to look at ourselves in the mirror. Michael Jackson said, "I'm working on the man in the mirror," and I don't know that we need to be doing as much working on that man or woman or person in the mirror as we should be fully accepting that one who's in the mirror. You'd be surprised at how you can upgrade your life by simply loving yourself. In fact, take just a moment right now to just hug yourself. Self-soothing. Psychologists tell us that when children even learn to soothe their own self, they learn to be much more confident and independent and strong. When they learn to soothe their own self, to love their own self. We should be teaching our children to hold themselves in high regard, not above others, to think they're better than anyone else, but to literally, really hold themselves at high regard. When you hear your children saying things that diminish and criticize themselves, help them. Correct that course, because if you don't, that's going to be a crash course. They're going to head toward a wall, and at some point they're going to hit it. And then they're going to need external forces to tell them they're okay. They'll find it in a drug, or they'll find it in alcohol, they'll find it in a boyfriend or a girlfriend. And then what happens when that substance is gone or that person is gone? Then they're lost. We need to learn how to love ourselves. Another part of loving beyond the veil is really getting... We need to really examine how we see the world and other people. We believe a whole lot, but we know very little, and yet we act like we know a lot. In fact, sometimes we get so dogmatic about what we believe that there's nobody in this world that can convince you otherwise. One of the biggest downfalls to relationships is someone in that relationship needing to be right. What makes it even worse is when both need to be right or have the last word. argumentative. I've got to be right, and I can't admit when I'm wrong. If you point out that I have been wrong about something, I just get ticked off about it, and I sull up and I go pout somewhere instead of dealing with it and just learning to live with it. One of the wonderful things that I've found in my relationship with Carrie is that we have this ebb and flow with each other, and we'll have disagreements. It's not that you don't have close, intense moments of fellowship, but you don't have to have fighting and bickering and bitterness and angst toward each other. You can actually find a way, if you really love each other, I think you do look for those ways to connect, not to disconnect. And love invites us into a space of humility. If you're condescending toward other people, I question your level of spirituality. When I see people who claim to be super spiritual, first of all, when I see people claim to be spiritual, I wonder about that. Because if you consider yourself to be spiritual, you may need to rethink that. Because if you are, you don't need to consider yourself that. The one who speaks has not, and the one who speaks not has it. You don't have to promote yourself if you are actually living in a functioning conscious awareness. Love invites us into a space of humility, a deep sense of compassion, and it also invites us to put the ego in the back seat and even in the trunk. And then we learn to live in a space of harmony and peace with other people. One of my favorite philosophers from way, way on back, an author, teacher, philosopher, comedian, really, was Mark Twain. And Mark Twain said this, I love this quote, "It ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so." It ain't what you don't know that gets you in trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so. I'm convinced this is my way. I know that this is the way it is. And ain't nobody gonna move me. See, I grew up in an environment where they said, you better stand up for what you believe or you'll fall for anything. Here's the problem. If your belief is not true, do you really want to stand on that? This is why I believe we should hold our beliefs very loosely and remember that you are not your beliefs. You're one who's capable of believing, but you're also one who's capable of altering that belief should you come in contact with a truth that says that belief's not quite it. Love invites us into a space of humility that keeps us teachable. It keeps our heart space open. It keeps us from being a know-it-all. It keeps us from being arrogant and full of ego. Folks, let me tell you something. The height of spirituality to me, the barometer for spirituality to me, is compassion and humility. When I see someone who's compassionate, touchable, humble, kind, loving, that's somebody that I can trust that they have a spiritual awareness, a self-realization. They have unfolded conscious awareness in their life. This is why I think Jesus said that love is the answer. He said it in every message that he preached, really. Perfect love casts out fear. God is love. And how can you say that you love God or that you even know anything about God if you don't love your brothers or your sisters? Greater love hath no one than this, than that they lay down their life for their friend. And Jesus went a step further and laid down his life for his enemies. Even when he was on the cross, one of the seven sayings that we find in the New Testament account of the crucifixion, even on the cross, Jesus says, "Father, forgive them. They don't even know what they're doing." The people who just nailed him to the cross, the people who would beat him and spat upon him and ripped out his beard and put a crown of thorns on his head. They said that he was beaten beyond recognition. Cephas, the historian, said that the beating that he took, it was a miracle that he didn't die before he ever got to Golgotha, which means the place of the skull, where they dropped the cross into the place of the skull. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do." That's powerful love. He could have spat on them. He could have cursed at them. But Jesus was so in touch with the reality of his conscious awareness, who he was, the Christ essence, that love drove him to even love and pour out love on those who were killing him. Now, don't you think about that just a moment. The next time you have conflict with somebody over politics, There's been a lot of that. Or somebody over a religious belief. Or just a simple conflict over where to go eat. Some folks get divorced over where we're gonna go eat. I don't care. Well, I don't care. But where you wanna go? I don't know. I don't care. Where do you wanna go? Well, I don't care. And the next thing you know, you have 5 minutes, 10 minutes worth of an argument. You're not even speaking to each other, and now you ain't eating anywhere. And if you're gonna eat somewhere, both of you gonna be on your phone while you're eating because you don't even wanna talk to each other. I'm just saying, loving beyond the veil to me is taking off all of the trappings of arrogance and pride and angst, and it replaces it with gentleness and kindness and meekness. And by the way, meekness is not weakness. Meekness is strength. Anybody can have a knee-jerk reaction. It takes strength to be able to hold your peace in the midst of a conflict. I love this poem, and I wanted to share this poem with you. I know I've shared it with you before, but maybe somebody needs to hear this today. And this is centered around this idea of I know. You know, I just know that I know that I know. Again, loving beyond the veil is that tremendous humility, the ability to be able to listen to others. Folks, if we don't start seeing each other and listening to each other, the gulf and the division is going to continue. We have to start listening and seeing each other in order to heal. Love is inviting us into that radical inclusion of even those who don't like you and those you don't like. Dr. King said this, "I've chosen love because hate is too heavy a burden to bear." This was a man who was beaten and imprisoned and ultimately was killed, but he was shot more than once before they assassinated him. If there's anybody in recent history who really did exemplify the nature of Christ, it was Dr. King, who was able to say, "I don't have any enemies. Even those who choose to be my enemy, I don't have any enemies." He said, "I may have opponents, people that I oppose their way of thinking, but I refuse to have enemies." That's Christ-like. And he was able to listen to other people, even people who were outright racist. He was willing to sit with them and listen to their grievance. And he disagreed with a lot of the things that were said to him, but he was willing to sit and listen. Loving beyond the veil is inviting us to be humble enough to hear each other, to see each other, to really desire to see each other. The title of this poem is "The Cookie Thief" by Valerie Cox. A woman was waiting at the airport one night with several hours before her flight. She hunted for a book in the airport shops, bought a bag of cookies, and found a place to drop. She was engrossed in her book, but happened to see that the man sitting beside her, as bold as could be, grabbed a cookie or two from the bag in between, which she tried to ignore to avoid a scene. So she munched the cookies and watched the clock as the gutsy cookie thief diminished her stock. She was getting more irritated as the minutes ticked by, thinking, "If I wasn't so nice, I might blacken his eye." With each cookie she took, he took one too. When only one was left, she wondered, "What will he do?" With a smile on his face and a nervous laugh, he took the last cookie and broke it in half. He offered her half as he ate the other. She snatched it from him and thought, "Oh, brother, this guy has some nerve, and he's also rude. Why, he didn't even show me any gratitude." She had never known when she had been so galled, and sighed with relief when her flight was called. She gathered her belongings. She headed to the gate, refusing to look back at that thieving ingrate. She boarded the plane. She sank into her seat, she sought her book, which was almost complete. As she reached into her baggage, she gasped with surprise. There was her bag of cookies in front of her eyes. "If mine are here," she moaned in despair, "the others were his and he was just trying to share." Too late to apologize, she realized with grief that she was the rude one, the ingrate, the thief. How often do we absolutely believe we're right about something, only to find out we were mistaken? And do we have the humility to say, "I'm sorry," or to apologize? Love invites us into a space where our hearts are open, and our hearts are even more open than our minds are, that we don't think of ourselves too highly or more highly than we ought to. We love ourselves, yes, but we want a sense of humility. How badly do you actually want unity? Do you want it only on your own terms? Because that, my friends, is not true love. True love is willing to ebb and flow and move like the water. Most of you know I'm mildly obsessed with this idea of us living as water. So I'll read this and then we're going to go into a time of meditation. "The supreme good is like water, which nourishes all things without trying to. It is content with the low places that people disdain. Thus, it is like the essence of Tao, or the way." Listen to this stanza. "Indwelling, live close to the ground. In thinking, keep to the simple. In conflict," listen to this now, please hear this. "In conflict, be fair and be generous. In governing, don't try to control. In work, do what you enjoy. In family life, be completely present." How often do we do that? Be completely present. When you are content to be simply yourself and you stop comparing and competing, everybody begins to respect you. Loving awareness, loving beyond the veil, is an invitation into this space of being like water. And if you're like water, you're humble, you stay low. The ocean is so humble, it stays low, and yet every stream of water seeks it out. It's the most powerful force on this planet, and yet it's the softest element there is. Think about that for a moment as you navigate through your daily life, as you start into Monday and Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and you're going throughout your week in your relationships where you have experienced conflict. Let me say this real quick to someone. There's someone who needs to hear this. You have felt for a long time that you can't have a relationship with other people because there's always conflict. Let me tell you this. If you are constantly finding yourself in conflict with relationships, you are the common denominator. And you must be willing to be born again and see yourself differently in order for you to enter into a space where you can have a healthy relationship. I promise you, if you're in and out of relationships and there's constantly a falling out, the first place we need to look is here, not in judgment, but in a sense of humility. I want to know what it is about me or in me that might be causing these problems in my life. It's a beautiful thing to find that sense of humility. Will you hear the invitation? Will you allow this invitation? Will you RSVP? To this invitation that Spirit has sent out to you today to check your love level. If you find yourself condescending to others and in conflict and in comparison and competition, you might want to check the level of your love and dial it up just a little bit. And you might be surprised how that brings solution to many of the problems. Let's take a few moments to sit together and allow ourselves to bring our focus to loving awareness. The truth will set you free, but it may tick you off first. It may grate on your nerves at first, but are you willing to let go? Are you willing to let go, to hold your beliefs loosely, knowing that you're not your beliefs, but allowing the knowing of pure presence, loving awareness, to guide you into that higher plane of consciousness? Today, I choose to let my heart heal whatever disappointments have happened in your life that made you feel that you had to shut your heart down. Let's let that go today and allow that heart space to open like the flower it is. Let's allow this loving awareness to bring a sense of compassion and kindness, humility, and grace. This is the key and the magic that brings about a life of unity and harmony. So good. So good. And so I let go of the conflicts. I let go of needing to be right. I let go of needing to have the last word. I let go of the stubbornness that keeps me from having a harmonious, unified, loving life. I let go, I release, and I let go. And in this space, I allow my heart to heal and become whole. Sweet Spirit of Truth, take from me what I don't need. Bring to me what I do need. My life, my being, all of me is surrendered. With my whole self, I say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. And so it is. And so it is. So it is. Thank you for allowing me to be with you today. It is my desire to always bring a sense of loving awareness and inspiration, and I hope in some way you've been inspired today. Much love to you, peace and grace to you. As I say in my meditations, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, namaste, namaskar, amitifo. Peace and grace, love and mercy, compassion, kindness, courage and strength, and all those good things, good things, good things. Much love to all of you. And as I've said, and I say this just about every time I do any kind of a service, make it a great week because you can.
Thank you, John. We appreciate your message. And it's always lively and full of interesting pieces of information and things to look at. And I just appreciate you. Thank you for joining us. And this is a time in our service where we get to be part of that cycle of giving and receiving. And it's through your donations, your effort, that we are able to live stream and get this unity message out to the community and out to people who want to hear it and need to hear it. We are needed here in our community, so we need to get this message out.
Your unfolding peace, show, Spirit, show through me as I open.
Announcements. Sunday morning, meditation, 9:30. Thursday noon, mindful musings. And both those are on Zoom. If you would like to serve and are interested in AV type work, we need a couple people to help Shannon with the Instagram and Facebook applications. And social media, that's where our future is going to be. That's where we are meeting people. Lynn is fabulous with the meetup group. And so we would like to have a couple of volunteers, people that would work with Shannon and train with him and such. So see Shannon on that. Barb and Jim Murphy are continuing the food drive and also things for the homeless. So contact them if you have that desire. We are going to have a fabulous guest speaker next week, Reverend Juan Enrique Toro. He was for 18 years the senior pastor at Unity of Costa Rica in San Juan, Costa Rica. In 1996, he co-founded the Spanish-speaking affiliate of Silent Unity. Now, that's a lot of work. They had 1,000 calls per month. That's a lot of folks they were helping. Starting in 2004, he served as a chair for the Board of Trustees for Unity Worldwide Ministries. He relocated to the States and was the interim minister at Unity of Fredericksburg. Currently, he is working as a chaplain with the healthcare community in New York City, and we know that he is needed there. So our prayers are with him on that work and that front. So please join us next week for Reverend Toro.
You know, one of the things that I'm very sure of is that love is the answer. Whenever you run into a situation where you can't figure out how to deal with a situation, I believe love is the answer. If you always have that as your default, if you practice loving, non-judgmental, living in that state of humility, living in that state of non-interference, lean to love. You'll never go wrong with love. Our friend Jason Mraz wrote a song that I actually really enjoy doing. And the title of that song is Love Is Still. answer.
Let's join together saying our prayer of protection. The light of God surrounds us. I am light. The love of God enfolds us. I am love. The power of God protects us. I am power. And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. And all is well. Let's join together in our peace song. Thanks for joining us today. Have a great week. You take care. See you next Sunday. Our peace song. Thank you.